you all, I wanna have a ball. I'm ready to go.
Let's go, ready or no.
Oh boy,
me,
I feel like
no.
I wanna raise the roof.
I'm hip, really I'm go.
Yeah, well that clock is probably jumping time. We'll be jumping through the night till the broad daylight.
Crash the gate with some friends.
Jump in, skirt,
hope the party
go.
Never ends.
It was something
what a party.
High. Really was safe.
My name is John Cleveland, and I work with the Toledo Lucas County Public Library, and we're here at the studios of WGTE Television with an opportunity to talk to Jon Hendricks. John has been one of my idols since I first had a friend force one of his albums on me in the late 1950s. It's a pleasure to be here with him, and we're going to talk about his life in Toledo as he grew up here, about the beginnings of his music career, and about his family. And I think one of the most interesting things is the amount of principle and ethics and standards that have influenced your life, that came out of your family, and that have influenced how you've lived your life since then. John, I understand that you started out as a child.
Yes.
And that you were born in Newark, Ohio in 1921.
Yes.
Is that right? Your father was an AME, African Methodist Episcopal Church minister.
Yes.
Do you, in your memory, did he have other occupations as well, or was that from the?
During the Depression, he had to go day work,
mm-hmm.
A little bit on the railroad, the B&O, Baltimore, Ohio, mm-hmm. but mostly cutting hair,
mm-hmm.
because in that Depression, there was no money anywhere. There's never been anything like that in the history of the world, I don't think. The saddest sight I ever saw was my father took me down to a food depot where the government handed out food, cans of food, you know. And there were lines of people, and you could see these men with their frayed shirt cuffs, you know, trying to maintain a little dignity, not shaving because who could afford to have a razor, but trying to hold their heads up, you know, and feed their families, but not being able to. So having to stand in line and get this food, and I was only about 9 years old then, but I understood. I always understood life. I could look and see in their eyes, you know, the defeated look on their faces. It'll never leave me. I'll always see that. And so my father and I went in and we collected our box of food and we took it home, you know, and it lasted us about a week and a half or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And there was no employment at all. And then Roosevelt ran for election and got elected.
Mm-hmm.
So there was no money in the treasury just because he got elected. That didn't fill the public treasury. There was still no money.
Mm-hmm.
So what he did was, okay, men, if they don't have work to feed their families, lose their self-respect. So if figured it out. Okay, give them a job. What job? Tearing up the street. Let them tear up the street. Pay them $35 a week. So everybody had a job.
Mm-hmm.
The men had their dignity back. They bought razors and they shaved.
Mm-hmm.
They were supporting their families, and so they had their self-respect. It was a marvelous thing to see happen. And then after they had torn up the street, then there was, what do we do now? Well, hire them to repave the street. And so they did.
Uh-huh.
And so during all that time, they organized other stratagems like the NRA,
mm-hmm.
and several other things, you know,
mm-hmm.
until there could be money generated to save the country. The man saved the country.
Mm-hmm.
And there are people in the other party that still hate that man for what he did.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're in power now, and people are in awful shape, and nobody's doing anything.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't forget that.
Yeah.
I remember.
Mm-hmm. Now, your family moved, if I'm right, to Toledo in 1932. Is that right?
I believe so. I'm not sure.
Uh-huh.
I think it was before that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it was mm-hmm. before 1932.
Do you remember what occasioned that move or what caused it?
Well, my father, being in the AME,
mm-hmm.
was shifted.
Okay.
Probably once a year.
So you had a bishop who made assignments to bishop, where you were going to be.
Bishop C.J. Ransom.
Uh-huh.
And he would shift my father. My father was very good at coming to little small towns like Kenton, Ohio,
mm-hmm.
where there was a broken down Negro Methodist Episcopal Church, you know, and then he would exhort all the farmers in the area, you know, to contribute, and he would build up the church.
Mm-hmm.
And then after he had done this, instead of being able to sit back and relax, Bishop Ransom would ship him someplace else, and another guy would drive up in his car and take over what my father had done. And I always resented that, you know.
No good deed goes unpunished.
Exactly right. Exactly right. I was very angry about that, and I'm still a bit trepidatious about institutionalized religion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think faith is a personal thing in a mm-hmm. person. You know, I think we individually are the church.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a direct line to the creator of the heavens and the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think we need anybody in between, except when they take all the money.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a sham.
Uh-huh.
You know? I don't believe in that. For that reason, I think, mm-hmm. watching my father work himself to death, you know.
There were 15 children in the family, right?
Yes, it was a family of 17.
Yeah.
15 and my father and mother.
Mm-hmm.
12 boys and 3 girls. We didn't count the girls. That's terrible.
Yeah.
But it's true, you know.
Uh-huh.
How many in your family?
Mm-hmm.
I got 11 brothers and 3 sisters.
Uh-huh.
It was really awful. That attitude that we had, you know.
Yeah. So having enough to eat and was a real challenge with the.
Oh yeah, my mother, she can make a breakfast out of anything. One day we didn't eat until 12 o'clock that night.
Mm-hmm.
My father went out to all the farms in the area of Kenton, you know, none of the parishioners had any money to give him, but they would give him baskets of potatoes or tomatoes or lettuce,
mm-hmm.
or some corn or whatever vegetable that they had over what mm-hmm. they sold on the market. And he would come home with these baskets full of things. And I remember we had this one meal at midnight. We hadn't eaten all that day. We had some Allager syrup and 2-day-old bacon fat,
mm-hmm.
and bread to sop it, and that was it. That was breakfast, mm-hmm. and we didn't eat until midnight.
Mm. I'm imagining that that you and the other children had responsibilities to help supply the income for the
however family. we could. Mm-hmm. I shined shoes downtown in front of the Paramount Theater.
Mm-hmm.
That was a good place, you know, to shine shoes.
Uh-huh.
Because after a while, I could go around the side and sneak in the side door and see the movie, whatever the movie was. You
mm-hmm. Your father, man of extremely high principle.
Yes.
Objected to places of frivolous entertainment.
Exactly.
I believe that's the phrase I've heard you use.
Yes.
His name somehow got entered in a lottery at one of the theaters downtown.
The Rivoli.
The prize was an automobile.
Nobody had an automobile in those days. Mm-hmm.
All he needed to do to obtain that automobile was to show up at the theater to claim it.
That's right.
And what happened?
He would not go. He would not go. All my older brothers were castigating him, you know, and he'd say, mm-hmm. shut your mouth. Mm-hmm. You know, and one of them called him a fool. Mm-hmm. So he knocked him out. Laid him out right in the living room floor. My father was a big man, you know. He had a fist twice mine, you know. Mm-hmm. He laid my brother out. And he says, when you get your own homes, mm-hmm. you do what you want in your own homes, mm-hmm. and you can say what you want. But not here. Mm-hmm. This is my house.
You know,
and he refused to go get that car, and my oldest sisters were mad at him, and all my little brothers were mad at him, mm-hmm. because we would have had a car, mm-hmm. and that was such a big, but he would not do it, because uh-huh. it violated what was in the book.
Mm-hmm. During much of your youth, while you were living under his roof, you spent a great deal of time in places of frivolous entertainment.
Absolutely. Absolutely. They never heard me.
Was that ever an issue between you and
him? No. My father was wise. He was like mm-hmm. Solomon, you know. Mm-hmm. He knew if he expressed his view on what I did, mm-hmm. he might feel that he's expressed his view and that's his right, and he had done that, but he also knew that it would not make me feel good. Mm-hmm. So he did the next best thing, he and my mother, and they said nothing. Mm-hmm. They never mentioned it. Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. wisdom. That's wise.
Mm-hmm. Your family, your father appears in the Toledo City directories from about 1932
yeah.
until around 1939 or 40. Did he go someplace else at that time? Or
Not till after 40. Then he got transferred to Greenup, Kentucky. Hmm. You know where Greenup is? It's outside Louisville.
I'm from Kentucky, kind of west of Louisville.
Oh, well, you know Greenup. Yeah. It's a little mountain hamlet, you know. Mm-hmm. And I went down there one spring mm-hmm. to visit him. You know, I was singing on WSPD then, you know, uh-huh. and we had some time off. So I went to visit my father, and he lived in this very rural area. You know, Greenup is rural. It's not mm-hmm. a city. Mm-hmm. So.
Another small church that the bishop wanted him to bring up from scratch?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So, across the hill, there's a little hill that separated our little area from the rest of Greenup. And across this hill, there was a white Methodist church. And so the white preacher used to walk over that hill every night and come and sit in the rocking chair on our porch and talk with my father. Mm-hmm. They were very good friends, you know. And this would happen every night, so I would take my school books out on the stoop, mm-hmm. you know, and I would, so I could listen to their conversation. Because I was always interested in mm-hmm. And so one evening, you know, the sun hadn't gone down yet. The preacher was disturbed about something, and my father saw it, and he said, Reverend, he says, you seem a little upset. I said, what's the matter? And evidently he had gotten a lot of flack from some of his parishioners for this nightly visit to my father. Mm-hmm. So he said, well, Reverend, he says, I just can't help thinking that my people are superior to yours. Now this probably comes from what they were telling him, because mm-hmm. he never mentioned anything like that before. Mm-hmm. So I was sitting there, and I heard the two rocking chairs, you know, they're going, you know, rocking mm-hmm. back and forth. And so my father said, well, Reverend, do you believe in God? And the preacher says, well, you know I do. Mm-hmm. And my father said, then what's your problem? And then the rocking started back again. And quiet, there's nothing said mm-hmm. for about 40 minutes. And then the preacher got up and says, well, I'll see you tomorrow night, Reverend. That was the end of the conversation. My father ended it exactly the way it should be ended. Mm-hmm. Do you believe in God? Yes. Well, what's your problem? That was it. My father was some man. He was a wise man.
Now, I've heard that your father saw you as the son who might carry on as a preacher.
Yes.
After him.
Yes, he picked me out of 12 sons. Mm-hmm. And I tell you, I wondered about this, you know. So when I met my wife, she was studying under an astrologer in New York, who the best astrologer in America, I think, at the time. And he was writing a book, and Judith was doing some of his charts. Mm-hmm. And so she knew a bit about astrology. Mm-hmm. And so I asked her, why do you think my father picked me out of 12 sons? And she said, well, look at your birthday. I said, yeah, September 16th, 1921. She said, well, what month is September? I said, it's the ninth month. And what day is your birthday? I said, the 16th. She says, what is 1 and 6? I said, it's 7. So you're born on the ninth month, on the 16th day, which adds up to 7. And which son are you? You're the 7th mm-hmm. son. Mm-hmm. And I said, my father knew this. Hmm. He knew this. He had to know this. I said, whoa.
I want to move back to when you were in Toledo. A couple of things that I ran across. You, at some point, Ted Mack, I believe it was.
Ted Mack.
When you were very young.
Yeah.
Solicited your services. Tell about
it. Oh, no, this was Ted Lewis.
Ted Lewis, that's right. That's right, Ted Lewis.
Ted Mack had the amateur hour.
Yeah, Ted Lewis was everybody happy, right?
Yeah. He drove up to my father's house on Collingwood, you know, mm-hmm. in a limo. And nobody's seen a limo, you know. Mm-hmm. And he got out and he came into the house, and my father and mother, you know, gave him coffee and set him down and everything. And he told him, he says, I would like your son to join me, and I would teach him what he would have to do, but because my shadow is first getting too old, and secondly, he's going to leave and go to Hollywood.
Mm-hmm. For the tune, Me and My Shadow.
Yeah. Yeah, because that was his signature mm-hmm. thing, and he opened with it in all his vaudeville stage mm-hmm. presentations, and the kid had to do everything he did, you know. Mm-hmm. He had to be an exact mimic of, mm-hmm. you know, me and my shadow strolling down the avenue. You know, it was all choreographed and. Mm-hmm. And well set, and it was a piece of cake for me. I could do it, you know. Mm-hmm. And my mother said, Mr. Lewis, I must tell you that I cannot allow my son to go on the road at his age. Mm-hmm. And she wouldn't let me go. Mm-hmm. And I cried all night. And I was so injured, you know. But mm-hmm. I understand what she meant, you know. Mm-hmm. She was right. Because, well, a couple months later, Fats Waller, whose father went to seminary.
Was also an AME minister.
Yeah, with my father, and they mm-hmm. were friends, and he would say, Thomas, when you get to Toledo, don't you forget to go see Evan Hendricks, you know. Mm-hmm. And I remember one day Fats came, it was the springtime, and mm-hmm. and he sat next to a window, and he gave me 50 cents. He says, get one of your friends to stand outside this window and hold my bottle. You know, he was drinking a fifth of gin a day. Mm-hmm. And so I got one of my little buddies to stand outside that window. And Fats was talking to my father. And he said, just a minute, Reverend. And he raised the window and leaned out and take a swig from this. mm-hmm. Because he couldn't drink in the house.
Your father would not allow it.
No. And he knew it. So mm-hmm. That's the way, that was his way of having his drink, you know. And I saw that and I was, I went into the kitchen so I could laugh.
Yeah, was your father aware that this is what?
Oh, my father knew everything. Uh-huh. Sure, he knew everything. Okay.
When you began working with Dave, when people became aware of your work with Dave Hendricks, with Dave Lambert
yeah.
and Annie Ross. And Lambert, Hendricks, and Ross was such a sensation. I remember a fellow in my hometown who'd heard of you and who introduced me to the recordings. And part of what made it such an effective entertainment was that you had taken some bebop lines, some melodic lines that were pretty complicated.
Oh,
they were
yeah.
pretty hard for yeah. The average person to follow. And you had put this very clever wordplay to them so that there was not only the music of this enormous quality, but also something that a person who was less musical could latch on to in the words. And the words always told a story.
Oh, yes.
And was that, you know, those features came together and I think played a great part in establishing how popular that group was.
Oh yeah, definitely.
But was that part of your plan? And I mean, was that calculated to do that?
Absolutely,
that purpose?
Absolutely. My father, when I was nine, he started me picking texts mm-hmm. from the King James Bible. Mm-hmm. for his sermons, because I was the most scholarly one in the family. I got mm-hmm. A's in English from the first grade clear through university. You know, I was very good with words. I was a scholar. Mm-hmm. And so he would ask me to look up Job 32:6. You know, so I'd turn to Job 32nd chapter 6 verse, you know, and then I would read what it said and mm-hmm. he would write it down. And that would become the text of his sermons. But along the line of doing this over the years, I was absorbing things like, for what doth it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? And I would say, that's heavy. That's a heavy mm-hmm. statement. And it's only a sentence and a half in the Bible. Mm-hmm. And I would think about that, and I would write that down, you know. Mm-hmm. And then it would say, have no fear. Be not dismayed. God is not mocked. For what ye sow, so shall ye reap. what ye sow in the body, ye shall reap in corruption of the body. And what you sow in the spirit, you shall reap in everlasting life. And I said, whew. You know, it was boggling my mind. Mm-hmm. I was getting anxious to get into this thing and find some more, you know. Mm-hmm. And then as I got into university and got out, you know, and got into full show business, I went to England with Basie and Lambert Hendricks and Ross, and I started to research before I had come to England who wrote the King James Bible. Well, it was Francis Bacon. And so I began to research Francis Bacon, mm-hmm, while I was in England. Turns out that he not only wrote the King James Bible, but he codified and made up the entire English language out of German, French, Spanish, and Italian. He used things like good soir. Good is German. Mm-hmm. Gut soir. Soir is French. And so finally, he made it English by putting evening behind the good. So good evening. Bonjour, good day. Francis Bacon did that. He and his society, the Society of the Rosy Cross, that was their job, to improve the education of mankind and to teach people. He wrote the plays and put them in the hands of a man named Shakespeare. Or Shakespeare, or Shakespeare. His name is spelled 15 ways. Mm-hmm. He comes from Stratford-upon-Avon, which is the, mm-hmm, bookless town. Mm-hmm. The mayor couldn't read or write. And so he takes these life lessons. A lesson in jealousy, Othello. Mm-hmm. What is it but a lesson in jealousy?
When you were in Toledo coming up, you hung around the theaters.
Yep.
You, later I have seen things where you've been interviewed or where you've written, and you've talked about the importance of showmanship.
Oh, yes.
And of relating to the audience. And there's an interesting thing that I saw someplace you had said. I think most people who look at the history of jazz tend to say there was this period, Louis Armstrong until the 1940s, when jazz was primarily an entertainment medium.
It's true.
And someone like Louis would put on a lot, you know, clown a lot, mm-hmm, and work to entertain the audience, as well as providing the greatest artistic music being made,
exactly,
at that time. And then the conventional wisdom is that in the 1940s, especially with bebop, many of the players began to see what they did not as an entertainment, but as an art.
Yes.
And sometimes the term American chamber music,
yes,
is used.
Yes.
And there tends to be much less in the performance of trying to entertain and much more of essentially saying, I'm presenting my art, take it or leave it. Here it is. And to many people, Miles Davis sort of symbolizes that. The,
yes,
frequency with which Miles would turn his back on the audience, or someone would be, someone at a front table would be making a lot of noise, and Miles would look at them and say, shut up, mother.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's kind of the image that most people have of Miles and of many of the musicians of his generation. There was the period where in that time where Louis Armstrong was made king of the Zulus at Mardi Gras.
Yes.
And many of the new generation of trumpet players looked down at him for playing that role.
And you, that's short-sighted, though.
You made a statement that you didn't think Miles minimized the showmanship thing, that you thought it was more a matter of his voice and the harshness of his voice.
Yes.
That caused that perception of him.
I think he used his botched operation on his throat to get rid of a node.
Mm-hmm.
The doctor, the doctor's knife slipped,
mm-hmm,
and cut more deeply than he should have.
Mm-hmm.
And so it caused Miles to talk like this, mm-hmm, And so he didn't want to come out on stage and say, "Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, it's nice to be here." He didn't want to do that. Mm-hmm. So he just came out and didn't say anything and started playing.
Mm-hmm.
And then when he'd get through, if he wanted to talk to the band, he'd go up and talk to him. It was back to the band. It was due to what happened to him, rather than any disdain for the audience, because mm-hmm, he was a thoroughly, thoroughly ingrained show business person. We all mm-hmm had to be.
Mm-hmm.
I was in vaudeville at the Rivoli Theater. I was what they call a filler.
Mm-hmm.
When somebody on the way between Lima and Toledo got a call from the Palace Theater in New York, then they would call the Rivoli and say, "We need a filler." So they would call Little Johnny Hendricks, the Sepia Bobby Breen, and I would fill in for that for that time,
Uh-huh.
And I got used to what show business was. You always dress when you go on stage.
Mm-hmm.
We had this stage manager who one time said to, I was out in the alley shooting marbles,
mm-hmm,
with the kids. And I'm 11 years old, So, he says, "Are you ready to go on?" I said, "Yes, sir." And he gives me a backhand right across the chops.
Mm-hmm.
Bam! Tears flew out of my eyes. What was that? And he said, look at your hair. And look at the knees of your pants." So I looked in the mirror and my hair standing straight up, So I would comb my hair, then I would rub the dirt off my pants. And then he'd say, "Now you think you're ready?" I say, "Yes, sir." Another pop. Bam. "What is that?" "Look at your shoes." And I look, and my shoes are all scuffy because I'm down on my knees shooting mm-hmm models. He'd say, "These people pay a lot of money for this entertainment, 50 cents. And they want to be entertained. They don't want to see no little ragamuffin coming out there on that stage. You clean yourself up before you hit that stage." This is what he taught me,
mm-hmm,
with two bangs on the jaw to emphasize it,
mm-hmm.
So to this day, when they say, "John Hendricks," I walk out sharp in a big smile on my
when
face.
When I picked you up this morning and you came down the stairs and I looked at that suit and that tie and the handkerchief, and I said to your wife, "I was just wondering what it would be this time." But it's always sharp, John.
I told Duke Ellington that year. I said, "You are the epitome of sartorial perfection." And he says, "Well, John, one should always look better than one's audience."
And certainly in that respect, Miles Davis's wardrobe.
Oh, Miles was cute as a button. This guy was sharp. He was dap. He was something. But that whole mystique that he created was due to his loss of his regular voice. That's why. He didn't want to speak to people and have them, So that's what he did. And he did create a new mystique,
Mm-hmm.
That a lot of artists...
Well, he reinvented himself, it seemed, yeah, about every 4 or 5 years.
Yeah. And a lot of other jazz artists copied
mm-hmm
what Miles did because he had to do something,
I remember specifically buying a blue pinstripe suit and a red tie with blue polka dots so that I could sort of look like Miles did on the cover of the My Funny Valentine album in the 1960s.
Yeah. I remember the first time I met Miles. I was, Dizzy picked me as vocalist for his first big band, you know, but I had left Toledo and gone to Rochester, you know, my wife and I and my son. And so when he came here looking for me. I was in Rochester, so he hired Joe Carroll. and I lost that gig, you know, which I've bemoaned all this time. But Dizzy said, you know, he said, look, if you had gone with me, you wouldn't have met Dave Lambert and Annie Ross, and you wouldn't have been who you are. So it's okay, you know. But I was in show business deeply by that time, and Dizzy was a great showman.
Oh, yeah.
That guy, he could dance, he was a drummer. Everybody was in show business. I mean, Jimmy Lunsford's band came to the Paramount Theater in Toledo and changed complete tuxedos three times. They opened in white tux. A couple of the acts came on, you know, a dancer and somebody else. Then they came out in an orange tux, and then they closed the show in black tuxedo. That's how show business conscious Lunsford was. You know, but it made a great show. It increased the audience's appreciation of what happened, not perceptibly, you know, but what is the word?
Subliminally.
Yes. Subliminally, they got a big entertainment value out of that. And I'm still in show business to this day, you know, because show business never changes. And it never will end. There'll be entertainers in heaven.
I remember one time when you were talking at my library, you told a story about some of the pretty entrepreneurial things you did to, in addition to shining shoes. I think you told a story about earning some money at the bus station where they had the pay toilets. Is that right?
Yeah. I used to like to go to the movies every Sunday, every Saturday, the Royal Theater. It was 10 cents. And my father didn't have any more dimes for us to go to the movies. It got that tough. So I figured out, okay, we'll go down to the bus station, which was down on the corner from the Royal. And we would stand in front of the pay toilets. And when someone wanted to go in, we said, just a minute. And we'd get out and crawl under and open the door and hold out our hand, and he'd give us the nickel. So I'd collect 25, 30 cents, you know, enough to take me and one of my brothers and get a big box of popcorn for a nickel, you know. And that's how we got to the movies.
Now, I think I remember also hearing about how you would go to Stanley's Hamburger Joint.
Oh, yes.
Where there was a jukebox.
Yes.
And what did you do when someone went to put a nickel in the jukebox?
Well, I would say, what are you going to play? And they'd say, what business is it of yours? I'd say, well, what are you going to play? I just want to know what you're going to play. I'm going to play Yard Dog Mazurka by Jimmy Lunsford, you know. And they'd have the nickel poised to go. I said, wait a minute. Don't put the nickel in. Give me the nickel, and I'll sing it. Yard Dog Mazurka? I said, yeah. So just to hear that, they would give me the nickel and stand there, and I would sing the whole thing. You know, the baritone sax. I sing the whole thing, and I would sing the tenor solo and the trumpet solo. And I got to be a kind of a cottage industry because kids came in just to hear me do this, you know.
I bet.
And I would do, if I didn't care more than words can say, the ink spots, you know.
Uh-huh.
Honey child, if I didn't care more. I would do the whole thing. To tell you the truth, I was amazing. It really was.
You were a one-man band.
It's true. And I made a lot of nickels. I earned money like that.
You know, it reminds me, in some ways, you imitating all the instruments. And I think about the times I've seen you perform, and in the middle of your scat singing and the solo part of what you do, you start to imitate a string bass.
Yes.
And you work your way through that bass solo, singing it and pantomiming the motions, and even singing a note flat and reaching up to the tuning peg.
Yeah.
It's a great piece of showmanship.
I don't know about showmanship, but I always wanted to be an instrumentalist so I could hang around with jazz musicians.
Mm-hmm.
And I took up the trombone. Mm-hmm. I actually bought a secondhand trombone in a pawn shop downtown. Mm-hmm. And I didn't go to anyone for lessons or anything like that. I just figured, well, this is the mouthpiece, and you put that in and you blow in that, and then the sound comes out, and this regulates what key. Mm-hmm. So I started to learn to play, and I was coming along pretty good, but I realized that I had not consulted anybody about embouchure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Which is, you know, the way you use your lips mm-hmm. against the mm-hmm. mouthpiece. You have to develop an embouchure so that you don't crush your teeth. Mm-hmm. And that's what I did. I turned my two front teeth around so that they didn't stay straight anymore. Uh-huh. I put pressure on them from the mm-hmm. mouthpiece of the trombone, and I turned them, and they started to ache a lot, you know. So I had to give that up. And so I figured, well, let's see, what else can I do now? I'll sing it. Mm-hmm. Whatever they play, mm-hmm. I'll sing it. And that really was the birth of vocalese right there, you know? Mm-hmm. Because that's what I did, and that's what I still do.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've been invited up on Dizzy Gillespie's bandstand, Count Basie's bandstand, Duke Ellington's bandstand, Miles Davis, every musician you can name, invite me up, and I scat as well as they do mm-hmm. or better than some of their other horn players,
mm-hmm.
you know, because of this desire I had to be an instrumentalist.
Mm-hmm.
And the only instrument that I had that I could manage was the voice. But since the voice is the original instrument, mm-hmm. then I'm more accurate than they are.